Very good evening, my dear friends. In today's session, we will deal with the topic of directors of the company, the definition, and then the basic provisions thereof, and then in this particular directors, the definition part, the status, and then their duties, powers, qualifications, disqualifications, removal, appointment, removal. These are all the things we are supposed to study in this particular chapter. So friends, well, this is a major part of fourth unit. And then I have already commenced the fourth unit with sending you some important material. So today, we will try to understand who are the directors of a company. Actually, it's a misnomer. A director should be a shareholder, qualification shares, unless the article stipulates it is not necessary. Anybody can be appointed as a director. Another important thing, the speciality of the Companies Act is that a particular person on whose directions the company is acting, irrespective of designation, he will be treated as a director of the company. That is the most important aspect of corporate law, company law. So, prima facie, what we should understand that a company is a legal person, and then it is not like a human being. So, it's a artificial person, then the company's objective is to achieve the objectives laid in the memorandum of association. That is the purpose of a corporate entity. So taking that, the company has to act through the shareholders, but there could be number of shareholders, so all shareholders cannot in fact work together. If it is a partnership firm, two partners are there and then two can sign and then two can do the work. But it's not the case with a corporate entity. A public limited company may be having a capital base of about 1 lakh shareholders. If that is the case, how are you going to handle it? So for that reason, there is a corporate democratic process through which in the general meetings or otherwise, ultimately subject to the confirmation in the general meetings, the company shareholders elect the directors as their representatives. And then the directors together called board of directors collectively and individually called directors are the eyes, ears, brain, hands and all other essential limbs of the corporate entity. And they are the agents of the company and representing the company, these particular directors act upon to achieve the objects laid in the memorandum of association. So, in the same democratic process, directors are elected. Then friends, prima facie we have to understand on the registration of a company becomes a legal entity, and then being an artificial person, it has to be led by the decisions of the shareholders, but they have to act in accordance with the Companies Act and as well as the Memorandum of Association and Articles of Association. So, the company has no physical existence. So it has to depend upon somebody or an agency. So the agency here is called the Board of Directors. The agency is called the Board of Directors, and the shareholders will ultimately elect their directors, and the directors ultimately collectively responsible to the shareholders will run the affairs of the company, and ultimately it is the majority of the shareholders' decision which will prevail on the company's running of affairs. That is first versus hot bottle. This is what we have studied earlier. So, the board of directors is the nucleus. and then selected according to the procedure prescribed in the Companies Act and the Articles of Association of the company. And then, friends, the Board of Directors acting collectively can exercise all the powers of the company, but that is subject to the Memorandum of Association and the Articles of Association and also the Companies Act thereon, along with the rules and regulations thereon. Then, friends, the success of the company depends upon the efficient functioning of the Board of Directors and their commitment, their motivation, their leadership and their honesty. So, the directors formulate the policies, and to achieve the corporate goals, they muster resources and control and guide and direct and further manage the affairs of the company. Actually, prior to Second World War, several business organizations were carried as one-man show. But subsequently, because of the economic necessity, economic activity, scarcity of goods and need for higher production and demand was increased, the business grew and corporate entity concept came to stay. And then the Industrial Revolution also helped. Then accordingly, the Board of Directors obviously started playing a very pivotal role in running the affairs of the company. And then, friends, several sole traders, like the Solomon Company case, Solomon and Company Limited. I have sent you the original case, wherein the individual business was converted into joint stock companies. And then the management bodies became the Board of Directors. And then, friends, the directors have got certain duties and then certain responsibilities. And the Companies Act is so meticulous that it has put every stage, the do's and don'ts for running affairs of the company. And it is the board which is responsible. And all the directors would be held personally liable sometimes in the event this particular the duty is not carried by the respective directors of the company. Friends, there are basically different types of the directors of the company. And then one type is that executive directors or whole-time directors, the managing director, the technical director, and then who are basically professionals. And then ultimately, there are other directors who are part-time directors. And then, there are another class called the independent directors, which are stated to be the appointees of institutions. This is under section 149 of the Companies Act. Earlier, it was under the clause 49 of the listing agreement of good corporate governance practice of SEBI. And then today that has been shifted to section 149. And then we will deal with the subject matter slowly as we progress in our discussion. In this regard, at the moment I am dealing with the concept of directorship. What is the concept of directorship? And then, in this regard, friends, there is one important case, Forest of Dean Coal Mining Company, 1878, 10 Chancery Division, 450. Where the English Court Chancery Division held that here it is the name does not matter, but function is everything. The function of a person in a company is important, and he directs under his control the company is running. He is the director of the company. So long a person is jury appointed by the company to control the company's business and authorized by the articles to contract in the name of the company and on its behalf, he functions as a director even though he is not called as a director. This is the most important aspect. Then, friends, another important thing is that the company is indeed a person, a juristic person, and the directors as a body endow the juridical person with human faith that can act and react. The human face is the board of directors of the company. So, friends, the executive directors are called the directors of the company who, in fact, have employment stake in the company, and then they could be employees as well as directors of the company. Now, friends, we come to the definition part where the definition part is concerned. This is under, you have to read section 149, read with 193, 149, read with 193, then the basic definition, section 2, subsection 34, and subsection, in fact, 39 and 60. Now, I take you to, as for example, in fact, section 234, where the director is defined as director means any director, a director appointed to the board of the company. That's all. Earlier, it was a different concept. Today, it is simply whoever is appointed as a director. This is one aspect. The second important aspect is that, my dear friends, section 2, subsection 39. This particular provision has got a significance that section 259, it is not 39, it is 59. An officer here is defined as an officer includes any director, manager or key managerial personnel or any person in accordance with whose directions or instructions the board of directors or any one or more of the directors is or are accustomed to act. This is where we are, in fact, put on a very important discussion that a director is under section 2, subsection 59, an officer of the company, number one. If he is an officer of the company, it includes any director, manager or key manager personnel and any person in accordance whose directions, or instruction, the board of directors or any one or more of the directors is or accustomed to act. That means the person would be even not called a director, would be deemed to be the director of the company. This is under section 2, subsection 59. Now section 2, subsection 60 says an officer in default. And here clause 5 says an officer who is in default for the purpose of any provision in the act is concerned. Here a director is named and any person, even not named as a director, in accordance with whose actual advice, directions or instructions the board of directors of the company is accustomed to act, other than a person who gives advice to the board in professional capacity. That means as a lawyer, I give you an advice, then I am not a director. But I am just a clerk. But without my permission, nothing is done in the company. Then section 60 clause 5 will apply, where I am a person, where in accordance with my advice, only the direction company's directors act upon. In that event, I am a director of the company and I am also an officer in default. Under section 259, I am an officer and I am a director of the company, even though I am not called a director. So, friends, here the question is that the definition of the director is based on function and not designation. This is the most important aspect. And then, a person is a director, if he does whatever a director does normally, and with whose directions the company works upon, acts upon. And then, the act in fact does not offer any specific guidance. We have to go by this particular analysis with the help of section 149, section 2, subsection 34, subsection 59 and subsection 60. Then friends, the one should attempt a functional definition. That's the reason why, as individuals who direct, control, manage or superintend the efforts of a company in the form of the board. As a body, in fact, they frame the general policy of the company, direct the officers of the company to do their respective jobs, appoint the company's officials, ensure that the staff carries its duties, and recommend to the shareholders regarding the distribution of dividend as per the profits and then other things. It is the power of the directors collectively to declare a dividend. You can't compel the board of directors to declare a dividend. That is a specific power vested with the board of directors of the company. And then the collective body in whom the authority is vested and through whom the company acts is called, as I told you, board of directors. And then there is an important citation here. This is Ram Avatar Jalan. Ram Avatar Jalan versus Coal Products Private Limited, 1970, 40 volume, Company Cases, page 714. The Supreme Court of India held that when a question arises as to whether a person is in law a director of a company, the minutes book and the returns sent to ROC would be taken as the important evidence, and then a person could be a de facto director if not a de jure director. This is the most important judgment of the Supreme Court. That's why I have been telling you time and again that vehemently, a person with whose directions a company is accustomed to act, then that particular person would be deemed to be the director of the company. So friends, now the question comes, there are different types of directors under section 149, read with other provisions. We will deal with the different types of directors. And then there are directors like independent directors, inside directors, and then full-time, whole-time directors. And then in fact, directors are not the partners of the company. So in this particular regard, this particular aspect of different directors, we will deal with as and when we come across. In today's session, I have given you a briefing about the directors and the basic legal status. Whether it is by function or nomenclature, it is by function but not by nomenclature, a person's identity as a director has to be decided. Either English cases or Supreme Court of India's judgment. This is the most important aspect which could cover a 20 marks question, and I have concluded. Now in tomorrow and other day's sessions, I will deal with the legal position of the directors. What is the legal position? That is jurisprudential perspective. Then what are the legal provisions as to how directors are appointed, how directors are removed, what are their qualifications, what are their disqualifications, what are their duties, what are their powers, all these things quickly we will go through, and then we will deal with the relevant provisions of the Companies Act thereon. Our study of directors is two parts now, with regard to the function of the directors, the status of the directors, whether they are agents, whether they are partners, no, and then whether they are having a fiduciary a duty, and then whether they are, as I told you, agents is one aspect, and then the other one is that whether they are trustees. What is the trusteeship concept here? These are all the aspects with the help of case law we have to see, that is study of the concept again. Second thing, appointment, qualifications, disqualifications, removal and all that is based on the legal provisions. So we will deal with the legal provisions thereon. So with this, probably coming 4-5 days, this aspect will be taken into account, and then we'll conclude our discussion. So slowly we'll progress well, and then thanks for your hearing. We'll meet again. Thank you. Good night. Bye-bye.